Welcome to the new sounds of J.W. Pepper, where we'll explore the newest music titles for school and church from the publishers and writers who create them. Each episode, we'll talk with a different publisher or writer about their top new releases for the coming year, along with behind-the-scenes stories and teaching tips that you wouldn't get anywhere else. In this episode, we're talking with Chris Bernotas, Director of Band Publications and Composer for Alfred Music. Chris is going to share some of Alfred's top new releases from their concert band and jazz catalogs for your consideration. Remember to check the YouTube description below, where we'll include links to all the pieces we're discussing today. Hello, Chris, and welcome to New Sounds. Thanks so much for joining us today. We appreciate you being here with us.
Thanks for having me.
All right. So we're going to talk just quickly about a few questions, just to get to know you and Alfred Music a little bit more. So tell us about Alfred. So what is the company's focus? Where is it located? How long has the company been around? Anything like that to get us a foundation?
Sure. The company's been around since 1922. I've been around since 1969.
And good to know.
It is good to know. Sometimes people ask how old we are, but you know, some people don't always share that, but I don't mind. But yeah, the company's been around for a very long time, a long history based in educationally founded music. And it's got a long history of pedagogical support. So it was started to teach music to teach and pedagogical approach to everything. And it's followed that path for almost 100 years. So pretty excited about that. I'm really excited to be a part of this company. Mm-hmm. I was a band director for 28 years and transitioned into this being my now full-time career on this side of it. So I love being part of a company that stands for connecting students and teachers with music and education. Mm-hmm. That's Definitely. A little bit. The company is located in Colorado, but I am located in New Jersey. So I am on the East Coast side representing East Coast Alfred.
All right. Yeah, I know a lot of the Alfred employees are kind of all over the country. So that's nice. What can someone expect to get when they purchase an Alfred piece?
You know, this is a really good question. And it's something that it's kind of in the philosophy of all of us who write music for Alfred. And for those of us that are editorial, that are acquiring music and what we're looking mm-hmm. for when we're looking at submissions. And to me, to put that into a little bit of a capsule is you can expect to get a great balance of pedagogy and artistry, because that's what we want. We want to be able to have music that connects and teaches, that teachers can look to for concepts for teaching their students and improving their skills at all levels, but also artistry. We want to have creative and thoughtful writing that kind of blends the two together. And that's a really tricky skill. And that's why some of our best writers are educators. And it's right from, so you can expect music that is from the front lines and not from some far off land where people aren't aware of what music education and what fifth grade saxophone players sound like. So we kind of stand for that. The other thing you can expect from Alfred is people that are here that don't just drop the music and run away. We're here. I'm tangible. You can call me. You can email me. I will talk to you. I will visit you virtually or in person or help in whatever way we can. I think I felt that as a teacher, and I feel that as a big responsibility as now a representative of the company. We're here for you in whatever way you need us to be. So never hesitate to ask for something.
Oh, that's great. That's great, because you're right. A lot of sometimes we don't feel like we can reach out to people whose name is on the music, or, you know, people who work for one of the big companies. So I think that's really great to point out.
No, when I was in band, I never even looked at the names on the page, or I never even thought they were alive. It just wasn't one of those things. And it's just kind of neat that, you know, no, there's lots of people, and they are still, many of them are alive and they love to share. All the writers and teachers, they love to communicate and help. Everybody's just so helpful.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, that's great. So what's new at Alfred? It's definitely been quite a year, and a lot of our publisher partners have invented or created new series to work through the pandemic and to address what customers are needing. So are there any new series or new composers that you want to tell us about?
Sure. I think, again, as part of this company history, if you go on the website, you'll see lots of really helpful things, resources like the blogs and webinars. And there's a huge push to do support for teachers that were at home. But even after people are back in school and things kind of normalize, hopefully at some point in our future, those resources are always still available. So I would turn to those, the articles and everything that's there. So that helpful part of it definitely had an uptick in the past couple of years. Things like SI Online, the video content and the supportive content that's available there with the method books, that has certainly been available in the past and still is. And then as far as new products, we really created, it kind of excelled a lot of products, I think, from a lot of companies and a lot of really well-meaning people. And it was a catalyst for things like our Flex series. We didn't have a Flex series. We have Flex products in the past, trios for all, quartets for all, that kind of thing. But in terms of the performance music, it really propelled us to get this Flex product developed and done. And I'll give you a little bit of background on how all the products that I've been involved with, it's always teacher based. Like, what do teachers really want? How do you want to use this? And I think one of the challenges with Flex products from everybody is, how do you use these things? They're confusing to look at. They're a little bit tricky to actually put into application. So I talked to a ton of teachers and say to them, what do you guys want? And the first thing they wanted was, well, this is probably crazy, but I want all parts for all instruments. And I thought, that's crazy. That's not going to happen. We just can't do it. It's not practical. We wound up doing all parts for all instruments
Yeah,
and
it can be
figuring
done.
out how to do that. Like, the tenor saxophones mess up the B flat parts, so we pulled them out so that we include separate tenor saxophone parts, so they actually have range appropriate parts. And then we've got all the right rules for the B flat instruments, so if you give it to the clarinets, they go over the break with, and we have all parts for all instruments. What if your most player, your top player is a tenor saxophone player? They always get stuck on part three, and part three never has the melody. Well, guess what? You can put whoever you need on the part that you need. And that was a big part of it, was this Flex series and teachers wanting guidance on how to use it. So we spent a lot of time trying to solve all those problems. And I'll share with you a couple of very quick things that we did with that. Because some of the things that we include are in the back of the packet that you get. And I worry that maybe some teachers don't go all the way to the back of the packet. So please do. Step one, go to the back of the book. Read the ending first. But we included, when teachers would ask me, like, how do I use Flex, these Flex products? I'm like, well, I don't know, unless I'm in your band room and see which kids you have and what their names are and what their strengths and weaknesses are, I can't really tell you how to use it. So we did provide a cool thing for helping in what we can. We did our parts there by transposition, and then we provide a teacher map. And this teacher map is pretty cool because, to me, I'm thinking, if I use this and I assign this piece to Susie, Johnny, and Bobby are going to play part one, and whoever are going to play part two, I'm going to forget that. That would be my problem. I would forget. So we wanted to make this teacher map so you can see it's got part one, two, three, and we have four part and five part. And you can write their names in here of who's playing what. But wait, there's more.
I was thinking that's already great.
I would already forget that, because then what do I do with this piece of paper? I'm going to put it aside and I'm never going to look at it again. So we have a line, and there's directions, so you don't have to remember. There's a line where you can tape it to the inside of the first page
Oh my
so
God.
that when you turn to the second page, it lines up and you can
No
still
way.
see. So this is what I thought would be really helpful for teachers. And while I can't be in every classroom to help you, hopefully this will be a tool and a resource so you can help yourself. We did
Oh, that's
provide the
huge.
menu of instruments to choose from based on whatever recommendations. And then you kind of do it as you need it. It's actually truly flexible. And I went to a school yesterday who was working on one of my pieces, and it was in a Flex format. So I got to see it in action, and it really was neat to make it. It was exciting. I
Oh,
mean,
and did it all work like you
it
thought it
did
would?
work.
And
That's
were they
always the
using
best part.
the score? Were they using the notes and everything?
Yeah, we used the notes, and I talked to the director before I kind of started running the rehearsal, and I got the lay of the land with who was sitting where and who had what parts, and also the strengths and weaknesses of this particular ensemble. And I just really liked the idea that you have to give up, as a writer, you give up control.
Yeah.
So I'm no longer in control of this piece. So I'm okay with that. I mean, I'm a teacher first. I want whatever is going to work best for your students. So when you give that up, and now this teacher is now in charge of assigning opportunities, which affects the voicings and might affect the harmonies. If it's, a tenor sax voice is now above where the trumpet part was,
Yeah.
it's a magical thing. Is it going to work? Let's see. It really worked. And
Oh,
we were
that's
able
good.
to talk about musical concepts, articulation, dynamics, communication, all that kind of stuff that we really are wanting kids to do, connect with. It worked great. So I'm super excited about that. We did actually just release our first release. We had 21 titles across all levels, Belwin and Alfred, pop, festival type music, holiday. We tried to get a bit of everything because that's what teachers wanted also. So we put 21 titles out as quick as we could. We also had to learn how to write these. That's a whole art in itself. Those were all retrofitted. They weren't from scratch. They were taking titles that were existing, and now how do we make these work? And then this year we just released a couple weeks ago actually, seven best sellers from Alfred and from Belwin. So best selling titles like Cumberland Cross, one of mine, Air Force One, which does really well. These are now released in a flexible format so that,
Okay.
more opportunities for everybody.
Oh, excellent. Can't wait to see those.
I know. I get a little excited. This is my teaching style. This is like, I don't know. I really actually believe in all of the stuff we're doing.
That's good.
I know, and I love that, So anyway.
My gosh. Were there any other or series or anything you wanted to tell us about that came up?
Yes, absolutely. One of the things that I've noticed from talking to teachers is with the pandemic and everybody being at home playing isolated, it really did actually help some students develop their musical independence and learn how to play on their own with more confidence and with a little bit more, you can't lean on your stand partner, so you had to kind of play on your own. But now when they're coming back together, some kids are struggling with how to play as an ensemble. And we do have a really popular series called Sound Innovations Ensemble Development, which is focused on all those ensemble skills: balance, blend, intonation. We isolate all those ensemble skills and have exercises that focus on those. You're going to focus on matching pitch. You're going to focus on clarifying articulations. And then we have a bunch of chorales that have actually been used in performance. A bunch of chorales by tons of great writers: Mike Story, Randall Stanrich, Robert Sheldon. You name it. They're on all these. So there's three levels of those. We have the intermediate level, which is green. We always talk in colors. Intermediate is green. So you have the Sound Innovations Green Book. You have gold, which is the elementary level. It's meant for the first day your kids sit down to play as a band. How do
Okay.
things change? So your book one is put the instrument together, make sounds. The gold book, we're now playing as a group. What skills change? It's very different. So that's the gold book. And then we have a purple book, which is the high school level. So it's an ensemble curriculum that works all levels. So that is something I wanted to highlight because teachers need that. And the feedback, which is always so important, feedback from teachers has been incredibly, overwhelmingly positive for years now. And I just want to kind of bring that to everybody's attention. It might not be new, but it'll be new to you.
Yeah,
So check
and
that
it's
out.
something we need right now, for sure.
Absolutely, for sure.
All right, well, speaking of that, let's get into the music, shall we? All
Sure.
right, so we're going to go through 10 titles, and the majority of them are concert band. There are a few jazz thrown in at the end. So these are titles that have come out this last year, right? I believe so. That you've picked, and we just want to highlight these. So if anyone hears anything they like, we are listing all the titles on our web on our description below. So feel free to click in and hear more. So let's get started. This first one we're going to talk about is Cool Breeze, and I believe this is one of yours.
It is actually one of mine, and it's kind of funny because you don't want just like blurb information. You want a little bit other story, a little other background stuff.
Yes.
So Cool Breeze was my self-given nickname. I was walking down the hallway with one of my colleagues at school a bunch of years ago, and he turned to me and goes, "Hey Chris, do you feel that? You feel that cool breeze?" I said, "I do feel that cool breeze, and that's a great nickname. From now on, I'm only going to be responding to Cool Breeze." So for for a couple months, I would only answer to Cool Breeze. So like one of my students would be like, Mr. Bernotas, can I go to the bathroom? Cool Breeze, can I go to the bathroom? Sure, go ahead. So
and your kids
yesterday,
told you that too.
And I swear I didn't plan this. Yesterday, I actually paid a visit to my school district, and my former colleague wrote my, I don't know if you can see it.
Nobody wrote Cool Breeze on there.
Wrote my visitor pass and wrote my name on it. So anyway, the piece of music, Cool Breeze, was actually, I really wanted to create something that would be like blues oriented and give kids an opportunity to improvise. And this goes back to that pedagogical balance in what we try to do with all of our pieces. I love how kids express themselves and create when they've learned those first three notes. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't stop a kid from making up new music and walking around the house playing their trumpet or saxophone, and they just make up music all day long with those first couple of notes they learn. But as they learn more and as they get more developed in their music, they create less. They get intimidated or scared or nervous. So I wanted that first experience to be here for them to improvise. So I mentioned before, go to the back of the book. We have these things called ed packs.
Yeah.
And in this ed pack, it's for all the different instruments, about the piece, about the composer, a form and analysis about the piece, terminology about the piece. On the back there are common themes written for everybody, the scales in the piece. So for Cool Breeze, for this piece, I did write out two solos. So as students build confidence, you can use the written solos if you want. The section repeats, and it can repeat as many times as you want. But we also have the blues scale at the bottom. So teachers can actually have kids play on that. And they can repeat the section as many times as they want. Really, it's just a personal goal of trying to keep kids excited about learning and creating and at an easy level. So it's risky to let kids improvise.
Now, are those pages reproducible, or is it like one for every instrument and that's how it is? Okay.
No, there's a note right on there. You're allowed to copy it as many times as you need. I guess I should mention that about the flex pieces too. You have permission to copy the flex parts. It didn't make sense to include like three copies of part one.
Yeah, because how do you know?
I don't know how many you need.
Yeah.
So there is permission to copy those as you need for your ensemble.
Okay.
Yep,
oh, that's
so
great.
Same thing with that.
All right, well, let's go back to Cool Breeze. Let's take a listen.
All right. Thank you.
I absolutely love the improvisation in the middle. I made a note about that when I was listening to it, because you don't see that in concert band music very often. And so,
no, and it's nice, and the really nice thing about it too is that the kids can hear the recording and model their playing after the style of the people on the recording.
And I was wondering when I was looking at the score, you know, where there's no chord changes down there. Like, how are these kids going to know what they're supposed to do? And then I read the little note about the educational packs. And so I'm so glad you brought that up. Just what a great piece. So I encourage everyone to take a listen to that one, because it's innovative. So
thank you.
All right, let's move to our next one for a total change of pace. Monsters Unite. Tell us about this one.
This is such a great piece. It's very creative. Kelly is a very thoughtful composer. I actually met her in Scott Watson. With Scott Watson, who's another fantastic, amazing writer, teacher, human being. He was teaching a summer course, and it was in composition. So there were tons of teachers and writers in his class, and a couple of us went to visit on a day. We had a roundtable discussion. Kelly was in that class, and clearly she learned a lot from Scott. The voicings are fantastic. I love that she's got transparency in her writing. So again, it's a little bit of risk-taking, but not so much that kids won't be able to achieve it. Mm-hmm. It's obviously fun. It's geared toward that Halloween spooky kind of a sound. I think there's a scream in there. You can't go wrong when there's a scream. And I just really appreciated how thoughtful her writing is. Again, thinking through every part and what kids can and can't do at this grade level, and then giving them some super opportunities for fun and expression.
Absolutely. All right, let's listen to Monsters Unite. To admit, this one totally caught me off guard. The scream at the end when I was listening to this, I love this piece. I had written down, oh, crazy percussion, flexitone, and timpani sounds, you know, just really fun. And then I got to the end and the scream happened, and I just burst out laughing, because it was such a fun piece. And that was just kind of like the cherry at the end. Just,
I kind of want to do the scream, like in the recording. Like, it would be so much fun to get. Who gets assigned the scream in the professional recording? It's got to be a great part.
it was so great. So anyway, okay, enough. Let's move on to our next one. Beyond Reach. Now, this one was also very cool. All right, tell us about this one.
So Adrian B. Sims is an amazing young writer. And I'll tell you something, that I'm a little bit seasoned, you can see. I'm youthful in my appearance and in my attitudes. Adrian is a senior at University of Maryland, trombone player. Yeah, and his music has such depth.
Yeah.
Beyond Reach, I mean, it captivated. I was working with Adrian on another project, and he sent me this piece, and I was immediately just drawn to it. Partially for the first reasons probably everybody does. This sounds like movie music. This is like,
I wrote that down.
So yeah, this is so cinematic. But what I really love about it is there are so many twists and turns that are unexpected. And I think that's what's really interesting about it. So as I've gotten to know Adrian through our editorial process is really neat. It's very collaborative. We work together, and the way the piece comes in the door is not the way it goes out the door. We talk through things and we discuss things, everything from harmony to form to structure to voicings to markings to all that stuff. And you really learn a lot about the writer and the piece, and you actually become like a protector of the piece and the writer. And what I've learned about Adrian and what I appreciate so much about him is he really thinks through every suggestion and thought, and nothing is a guess. He thinks through it and is confident with his decision making. And by the way, those editorial suggestions and thoughts, it's totally coaching. It's not directives. It's you make this decision, but here, maybe this will help you.
Absolutely.
And again, another recent experience, another piece of his that we'll maybe talk about next time around. I worked with an honor band recently, and the snare drum part was really tricky. And I was playing it next to the student, working with her on it, and she was playing it fantastically. I called Adrian the next morning, and I'm like, "Listen, we got to talk about the snare drum part from these measures." And some people might be like, "Oh yeah, change it, change it." Adrian's like, "Let's think about it. What are the best ways we can go with making this more playable but still achieving the same feel?" Fantastic. And I really appreciate it. So don't let age mean anything.
No
You
way.
know what I mean?
No way.
His maturity and his thoughtfulness are, it makes his music even better. And I love that. Another little tidbit is not only did Adrian write great percussion parts as a trombonist, he also, when we talked about that particular part, he plays all the parts. He's got pads and he plays them like in his dorm or in his house, and he actually plays through all the parts. And I think that speaks so highly of him as a person and as a writer and as a potential teacher. So that's maybe not specific to Beyond Reach, but that's specific to Adrian B. Sims. And I love representing his music. Kids are going to love playing this piece,
I
and
agree.
I can't get enough of it. It's great.
All right, now we've totally built it up. Here we go. Let's listen to Beyond Reach.
Thank you.
honestly, this piece, it caught me right from the beginning. And I told you, I did write down movie score sound, but yep. the part that really got me that was different. Cause I was like, okay, it still sounds like a movie. There's singing in this piece. There's like an section. And that was different. I love that. Yep. Cause you hear that in movie music, but you don't hear that in concert band music very often. So.
Right. And the thing too about that was like sometimes concert band people, kids, me, we're self-conscious about our voices.
Yes.
And I feel like the way that that's written in there, you can do it as a hum. You can do mm-hmm. it quietly. Nobody has to know it's you. And you're really, and what happens with that is like when one person starts to do it, another person will start to do it. And it's going to give that ominous feel that it just changes the whole texture. I just, exactly. It's inventive and it's just really different. I love it.
Yeah, it is. It's just a really great piece. So definitely take a look at that one if you haven't heard it yet. So, all right, next, this one, I don't know, it was between this one and Beyond Reach. This one might be my favorite of the whole pile here. Magic City Montage. Tell us about this.
So Robert Sheldon, I think that's pretty much all I really need
to
say.
That's it. So.
He is and always has been like a role model for all of us. Obviously he was editor, he's my editor, and I learned so much. This collaborative spirit was my first working with Robert Sheldon, and he is just a masterful writer, a thoughtful human being, and completely detail oriented in all of his work. In fact, the quick behind the scenes story was the first piece that I had accepted from Alfred was called Pony Express, and Bob sent me about 80 bullet points of suggestions. And I mean, it was my first piece. I was literally that guy. I was that guy that I sent it in the mail, never did anything. I mean, I did arranging and lots of arranging, but I sent, never considered stuff for publication. I sent it in the mail, and 3 months later, I got a phone call, and it was Robert Sheldon. So that was it. And then I don't know what he said for the next half hour because I was just starstruck, like... And it was probably a flip phone, so this is an accurate depiction of that. So anyway, so his writing is fantastic. And I always counted on it as a teacher, and I count on it now as I continue to learn from him and his writing. And Magic City Montage, obviously Magic City is the nickname for Miami. And this is commissioned for a group in Miami. And he tried to encapsulate all that sparkle that comes from Miami and all that diversity in that community and everything about it. And he does that. The thing about his writing is at all levels, but even the challenging level, it's easy to rehearse. It's written in such a way that you can make a rehearsal plan and get kids and adults and community bands to play it really well. They're very well thought out. And another behind the scenes tidbit for Magic City is I remember when he was actually writing this piece, because once in a while I get a little magic in my email. And this particular day, Bob sent me an email on some other topic we were talking about, and he was writing this, and he's like, hey, Chris, I know you'll be interested in this. I'm working on this piece for this commission, and I'm writing a danzon section of this, and I think you'll like it. Give it a listen. And he attached the little recording of it. He wasn't even done with the full piece yet. And again, I remember vividly being in my kitchen listening, like, that Bob, he did it again. This is amazing. So... he has a way of making the music sound exactly like it should, and also teachable. So that's the little behind the scenes for Magic City, and I know that this is just going to be loved by all who get to play it.
Yeah, all right. Well, let's listen to Magic City Montage.
Thank you.
Itself, it's really sophisticated. I mean, it's difficult. It's got mixed meter, a ton of 16th note runs all over the place for every instrument, even those, you know, brass instruments, those low brass that don't normally get the 16th note. I'm a woodwind player, so I'm used to that. It was written for the Miami Symphonic Band, correct? Is that a community band?
It is a community band.
National band, okay.
Tom Proctor was one who commissioned the piece. He's another fabulous musician in and of himself. And great players like to surround themselves with great players. And you mentioned about the runs and things like that. I mean, they're practicable things. Those pieces, mm-hmm. those sections are very playable. They're one of those things. That's something I would give my students and know that they're not going to get it on the first try.
No.
And that's good. That's a good mm-hmm. thing. Kids have to have a little bit of that difficulty, like, and learn what hard work is. But I also know that if I gave that piece to my students, they will get it.
Yeah.
So it's not like one
not
of those
difficult.
Pieces. Yeah. It'll take some time, you know, and it's just great. And just musically, it's so satisfying. So, and you're right, the opportunities for everybody, it's great. I like to think of it as a really good writer thinks on both sides of the stand. You think mm-hmm. as the director, and what am I going to use, and how is this going to be in the concert, whatever else. But you also have to think about it as the third trombone player on that side of the stand, mm-hmm. or the second clarinet player, or the first clarinet player. So a really good writer will think on both sides of the stands, mm-hmm. and clearly Mr. Sheldon knows how to do that.
Indeed. All right. Let's move on. Something a little bit different. Crossfade. Now, this one has a subtitle of Quarantine 2020. So I wonder when it was written.
So Patrick is another one of those thoughtful writers. He's an active teacher in Alabama, working with students every day, and actually lived through the challenges along with his kids and that quarantining. And you know, the crossfade is when one thing fades out and another thing picks back up. And he was talking about how that whole time period of the shutdown, it just one day just shut down and led into the next. You almost lose a sense of time in that. And that's where he kind of came up with that title. And it's kind of, he dedicated to that class, to that group of students that he was working with that year, which I think is really special too, because it's one of those things where you go through an experience with a particular group of people and you'll always remember that. Mm-hmm. So I think there was a really nice dedication on his part. And then forgetting all that and thinking musically about this piece, man, is it different. It, to me, it's just so, the words that come to my mind is are like, it's quirky, but tangible. It's different, but not weird, or it's a good weird. It's dissonant, but it's intentional. It's just got all these different, again, those different types of things that get your attention. Like you expect to the unexpected, and it's really just engaging to listen to. And then the teaching parts of it. I love that there's many teachable moments, like the difference between a tenuto and a staccato, and you have to perform them properly. Or just the construction of it. The melodic line is a legato smooth connected line, but the accompaniment are these short, offbeat, not predictable rhythms. So just even talking about the structure of music and how do these parts work together, I think is really how a teacher can approach this piece. And to me, what makes it special, even different than the message that the piece gives by title and subtitle.
Oh, it's great. I put on here too, I was like, uncertain chords. You know, they weren't, and then I read in the notes, he said dissonant. I'm like, yes, that's what it is. They're dissonant, but they don't quite resolve. You know, it's just kind of,
right.
It is that crossfade that moves into other things. And so you're right, very interesting piece. All right, let's take a listen to Crossfade. Fun piece. Okay, again, very different. Now moving to Asteroids, Mike's Story.
So Mike's Story is another just master that I am so thankful to even get to talk to. he's so amazing in his writing. Mm-hmm. People, including myself, love Mike's Story's music because it works, number one.
Yeah.
There's a reliability that this is going to work. None of this is by accident. Mm-hmm. And each level, his voicings are perfect, his harmonies are excellent. And to me, what makes this particular piece, and actually the next couple that we're working on, so special, is he has a different way of connecting to the material. So the piece Asteroids, it's a really, first of all, it's a great title, and that's hard sometimes. It's just great. Asteroids, who doesn't want to learn about asteroids? Who doesn't want to play a piece that's named after different asteroids? I'm not going to try to pronounce them, but there are three different ones that he marks in here. So not only is it musically interesting, and first of all, it's a multi-movement piece at this level, which is fantastic. So kids can get the experience of that and different styles throughout. But when he sent this to me, not only did I do all the editorial stuff and study and make sure everything was the way it should be, which was easy, but I also went and I looked up information about these asteroids. What inspired Mike to do this? What is this asteroid? What is this one? What is that one? To me, that made me think, if I'm curious, I think there's going to be a lot of kids that are going to be just as curious. And to me, that thoughtfulness is just as brilliant as the writing. To be able to get a kid to look at and learn music, and then maybe to inspire them to go outside of the music and learn something else, is brilliant. And
well, that's the just another teacher, layer. I love it.
Yeah.
So these are legitimate asteroids, the three names that are in here. Okay, I was wondering that.
Yes. And you can go look them up and you know, check on Smithsonian and all the different, you know, websites and get some information. I know that's what my kids would do. You know, maybe they'll do that next year. So.
Oh, absolutely, though. This is very cool. All right, let's listen to Asteroids. cross-curricular music at its best. And I do, every one of them has a different personality, so to speak. So I think it's really interesting.
Yeah, he encapsulates that really, really well. And then again, it's pedagogical too. I mean, everything is thoughtful. You know, are they in the right ranges? And, you know, he just has a great way of picking all the right colors, you know, so that they can get the right experience.
Very cool. All right, next one. Fanfare Noblesse.
Yeah, what a great piece this is. I loved it from the second I heard it. Again, I'm a fan of Roland Barrett. His music, his textures that he comes up with in all of his different pieces, in his whole catalog, his textures are what always stands out to me. If it's Arabian dances, it's just it gets it all right. And in this particular piece, it's a fanfare and it's noble. And man, does it really achieve that. The thing that stood out to me with this piece was it's got an Olympic sound. I don't know if you heard the same thing, but it's very reminiscent in a very positive way, not in a rip-off-y way, very reminiscent of Olympic themes. And even listening to a computer recording before real recordings, it makes you kind of sit tall and kind of feel that, you know, power and confidence. And then the other thing that he always does that I really appreciate is his percussion writing. He's also a fellow trumpet player, but we also think he thinks on both sides of the stands and behind all the toys and behind the band. I have another personal mission, which is do not keep percussion students busy, keep them engaged. And you know, there's a big difference between those two words. Mm-hmm. Being kept busy is one thing and being engaged is another. And I'll give my wife credit on this too. She said to me one day, she's like, you know, those kids didn't sign up to be kept busy. They signed up for the same reason the trumpet player signed up. They want to make music. So that's why I really appreciate somebody like Ron who thoughtfully writes percussion parts. There's a lot of them. So directors with not a million percussionists, because I know everybody thinks like everybody has a zillion percussion players, which many do, but some don't. So you may have to pick and choose which ones to omit, but they're perfectly placed and just really, really well done. And the other feature in this one is there's multiple tonguing in the beginning. He's got these 30-second notes that everybody might not be able to play. So actually inside page one, there's three different ways you can do it. So we talked about how to do this, because if you don't have students that can do, you know, double tonguing, you can maybe have, you know, an eighth and 2/16ths, or even 2 staccato eighth notes. So we actually put a graphic in there to show that. But I liked the opportunity being there to let kids go for it.
Oh, yeah.
And since it's on a single note, it's not like digga digga da, da, digga digga da. You can do, it's a little bit easier to achieve. And it's a valuable skill that players will use for the rest of their playing life. So I thought it was a good opportunity for this, and to me made it an extra teaching component for it.
Absolutely. I mean, if they're playing at this level, that's something they should be working on. So
I agree. Yep. Totally agree.
Excellent. All right. Let's listen to Fanfare Noblesse.
Thank you.
and I have to admit, yes, the feel of this, the note I wrote down was stately. So
yeah.
Olympic fanfare, stately, you know, the same kind of thing. Definitely a great opener too.
So. Absolutely. Yeah, all I would right. definitely love to start a concert with that.
I think the next three pieces were, I mean, two of them are jazz, but this next one is a definite transitional piece, Swinging on the Moon, still concert band, but we're getting into jazz. So tell us about this.
So Swinging on the Moon, obviously we're playing with the concept of moon, right, with the titles of the pieces in the medley. And it's another one of those, it's one of these kind of pieces that I really feel we need more of in the concert band world. Not that people don't include flutes, clarinets, and bass clarinets and French horns in their jazz bands. Maybe some don't do that. Maybe some do. But those kids love jazz just as much as everybody else.
Yes,
and
they do.
I love teaching that. I love teaching it with my students. And, you know, a really great arrangement is defined by the transitions. I think we all kind of know that. You know, the meat of the music is the music, and the transitions and the creative twists that an arranger comes up with is really what sets it apart. And Mike Kamuf took this challenge and ran with it. And I think this is going to be a staple in any kind of community band or any kind of high school band that wants to expose all their students to playing swing rhythms, creative writing. And it's really, when you listen to this and when you play this, again, it's one of those pieces that make me feel like I just want to get in there and play this. And I want to teach this with students and just let them enjoy it. And again, it might lead them to other pieces. Mike Kamuf is a very special writer. Again, he's a teacher and he teaches everything. He teaches band, he teaches orchestra, he teaches jazz. And it's that boots on the ground kind of approach. I mean, he lives this with all of us. So he knows what kids can and can't do and also where to push and how to get that authentic sound from these arrangements. And I think he did an amazing job with it. Of particular note, there's a section, I think it starts measure 77, where you have to go back and forth between straight eighth notes and swinging eighth notes.
Ooh.
That's going to be tricky. That's going to be a challenge. And it's one of those challenges that would make me like smile, like when the kids nail it, get it right. And when everything locks in, this piece is not only going to sound great, it's just going to feel great to achieve it. So I'm so proud of this one and Mike's work on it, and can't wait to hear other performances of it going forward.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay, here is Swinging on the Moon.
Thank you.
It's funny that you mentioned that this sounded like an authentic piece. I wrote on here, authentic jazz big band sound.
Yeah.
I mean, it does. It has that big band kind of feel, but it is a concert band. And as a flute player, I have to say thank you. It is. I was not playing flute in jazz band. I played the piano instead because there was no spot for my flute. So,
yeah. I should mention too that it does include an electric bass part.
So okay.
He does have that too to add for other opportunities. But yeah, you know, like I said, kids love music and they should be able to create it. And you know what? We have tons of parts. You know, if you look at our jazz pieces, there's tons of downloadable parts where you can incorporate the other instruments, even flute parts and all that. I'm a more the merrier kind of guy. Mm-hmm. So I think if a kid is excited to try something, my role is to help support them in their exploration. So that's
agreed.
That's my feeling.
All right. On that note, let's move into some jazz. So we've got two titles here. This first one, My Man Sam for Sammy Nestico. Tell us about this.
Yeah, so Pete Barenbrink, our jazz editor, is a master at just pretty much everything. He's a master performer, master editor. He gets the best out of all the writers. And when you're blessed to be working with people like Gordon Goodwin, I mean, that's just, it's mind-numbing in some ways and amazing. And this particular piece, for all the reasons Gordon Goodwin music is fantastic, and I loved it as a director and I love it now, it's different and it's really unique. His sound is unique, but this piece in particular is super special. I feel like many people have a Sammy Nestico connection in some way. Mine was in high school and I played in jazz band. And I was lucky to be able to play some high notes on trumpet. So we played some Nestico charts and just, they always stood out in my mind. I didn't know at the time what I was experiencing, but then it hit me like, why this is great. So this nod and this delivery of this piece in honor of Sammy Nestico is just really special. And I actually got a message from Pete about it because I asked a little bit about it, a little behind the scenes. So I'm going to read you the note from Pete. My man Sam, Gordon wrote this before the great Sammy Nestico passed away with the intention of having Sammy hear the big fat band version as a tribute to Sammy. Gordon's introduction to the genius of Sammy Nestico was in high school playing Queen Bee, and it was at that point that he knew how perfect Sammy's charts were and still are. That was a significant step in Gordon's motivation to become what he is today.
Oh,
that's incredible. He said, moving to the present, because Sammy's health was failing before Gordon could record it with the Big Fat Band, he brought him a homemade piano track of the chart for Sammy to hear. I mean, try not to cry. I'm a crier, so it's like, you know.
Don't do it.
But listen, this music that's written from the heart and for somebody who's had such a deep emotional impact on Gordon Goodwin personally and for the rest of our greater musical community, there's no greater motivation or an inspiration for a piece of music. Mm-hmm. And this is just great, straight up swing chart. I mean,
it's
fantastic. So I don't know if there's anything else I could really say about
My
Man Sam.
No, it's great. All right. I think let's listen. My Man Sam. swing. It really is. Lots of unison and solos. I also put on here easier than other Gordon Goodwin titles.
That is true.
You know, but still, I mean, it's really accessible to all kinds of students, and especially those that have played Saminesco. You're right. I mean, I grew up playing it too. And this, it just sounds just like it. It's great.
Yeah, he really encapsulates. I mean, if his mission was to pay honor to him and write in a style that, you know, pays tribute to him, he nailed it.
Yep, totally did it.
I'm sure that he made Sammy proud.
Oh. All right. Hopefully you won't cry on this next one. Stomping at the Savoy. Now, tell us about this one and how this one differs from all the other arrangements out there of this one.
So again, we're back to Mike Kamuf, and mm-hmm. I didn't tell you his whole story. I did say he is a very well-rounded, multifaceted educator. Mm-hmm. He's also a trumpet player, a jazz trumpet player who plays. He plays in clubs and plays in his, he's got his own band that he's out there living the scene in the jazz world. And one of the things that Mike does often is he listens. Anybody will tell you, to be a really good jazz player, you've got to listen.
Yep.
Just listen, transcribe. You've got to learn the vocabulary by living in it. That's what Mike does. There's this thing that old people use called Facebook. And Mike, yeah. I don't, you might have heard of it. I don't know. And Mike often posts pictures of the vinyl that he's listening to, and he's always inspired, and he's always living in those charts, in the Nestigo charts, and in the Bill Holman Kenton charts, and all the Benny Goodman charts, the originals. And he's often challenged with, how am I going to do something different? And he really does that. I think Mike has a really instinctual way of grabbing what was great in the older arrangement and putting a twist on it to make it something new, or to kind of make it his own, and then kind of letting it free for interpretation with solo areas and all that kind of things. So that's kind of what Mike does. And I think there is, I don't want to overuse that word authentic, but if there's a genuine honesty in his writing, mm-hmm. that's exposing who he is as an artist. And you get to do that through arranging and through taking like what Stomping at the Savoy has meant in his own development and his lifetime of listening to Goodman and Kenton, and now reimagining it with a little Kamuf twist. And I think he does that beautifully in this piece. And again, accessible. Mm-hmm. Most bands are going to be able to play this, and it's going to be another launching pad to maybe excite kids to go and look up those other arrangements and trace the history and connect in a different way.
All right, let's listen. Stomping at the Savoy.
Thank you.
Awesome. I loved it. I didn't have any other notes on it. I was just like, yep, that was amazing.
That's good. That's a good thing, right? And you don't have anything? It works.
It's great.
I love it.
Okay, well, that wraps up. That's the end of our 10. So do you have any parting thoughts for our viewers?
The parting thought that I would say is thank you to all of the teachers that are pushing through all the challenges that come your way. And I'm not just talking about COVID challenges. I feel like teachers are often underthanked. And I think teachers are appreciated, but maybe that you don't hear it enough. And you should know that you're appreciated every single day. I'm a parent, I am a fellow former director, and I appreciate the teachers in my own community, and I try to make sure that they know it. So I hope our greater community at large, educators that are watching this, I hope you know that you are valued every single day in challenging years and in the not challenging years. It's hard to be a teacher. It's hard to be a student. And as a representative of Alfred Music, we care about you, and we are here to support you. And you're on the same mission we are, to connect kids, people, humans with music, and to experience the joy of making music. So thank you for all that you do, and please keep at it. Sometimes you want to give up, but please don't give up.
Oh, yes, ditto, all that. That's wonderful. And that's what we look at too. I mean, teachers are completely underappreciated, and that was a thing prior to the pandemic, and now it's gotten, right. It's just so hard. So we love our customers.
We do.
And yes, we do. Okay, well, I think that wraps it up. So thank you, Chris, so much for taking some time to talk with us today and introducing us to all these great pieces of music. I hope people go right out and check them out. The links are all below in our description. And hopefully we'll have you on for another episode sometime soon.
All right. Thank you so much for being here with me or inviting me to do this. It's been a lot of fun. You know, sometimes these things make you nervous, but it's so much fun. So,
my pleasure. All right. Thanks again.
To wrap things up, remember the links to the titles we looked at today are in the YouTube description. And you can find all of these titles and more at jwpepper.com. We hope you found this video helpful. We know that picking new music can be tough, and we're here to help. If you did find this video helpful, give us a thumbs up. And be sure to comment below to let us know of any ideas you want to see in future episodes. And don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss any new content we have coming out at JW Pepper. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time.